Hello, hello everybody. So today we'll have two seminars. The first one is a seminar from François. François is a lecturer or associate professor in Toulouse at the Institut Mathématique de Toulouse, and he's done a lot of work on Gaussian process, most of them on the more statistical side. Like, he has a very, very strong statistics background. If you have statistic questions, just go and ask him. And yeah, he's been supervising Andrés Felipe López Lopera, that most of you I think I've met 2 years ago when he did a placement here at Second Line. So François, floor is
Okay.
yours.
Yeah, thank you very much for the invitation and the opportunity to visit for today. So as I said, I'm visiting Mark Vanderbilt this week at Imperial College London. And so Andrés is one of the authors of the talk. So Nicolas and I were supervising him. And then Olivier was also a supervisor of Andrés. And this is a work that came after Andrés' thesis, but it's a follow-up on the topic. So with Olivier, me, and Andrés. So the general topic is Gaussian process with inequality constraints. So typically, we know that a function of interest is monotonically increasing with respect to some inputs. This is mainly motivated by computer experiments in the modeling of physical systems. Then we want to enforce this constraint in the Gaussian process model. And with this, we have a procedure based on finite dimensional approaches that was validated in previous work in the context of the thesis of Andrés. And now with this procedure, we have a problem to go in higher dimension. And so this work is about a sequential construction to improve the procedure in a higher dimension. Okay, so the content of this talk corresponds to this preprint online. Okay, and we'll divide the talk into four parts. So first, I will give some reminders on constrained Gaussian processes, and we'll see the finite dimensional approximation and then the problem in higher dimension. Then we'll see our proposal to go to higher dimension with this type of finite dimensional model. It's an algorithm that is a greedy optimization algorithm that we call MaxMod. In this section two, we'll show the algorithm and some of the numerical experiments. And then the last two sections are more theoretical. It's about proving the convergence of the algorithm. And in proving the convergence, we have suggested a mathematical object that we call the multi-affine extension of the function. Okay, so we start directly with constrained Gaussian processes. So we know that Gaussian processes form an infinite dimensional prior over functions. So they typically generate curves that look like this. And then it is known that with Gaussian processes, a Gaussian process is not bounded, is not arbitrarily bounded between some values. And also, it's never increasing with probability one, for instance, which is what we would like to do. So, especially motivated by the modeling of physical systems in computer experiments, sometimes we know that the output of a function of interest is bounded. For instance, if we model a chemical computer experiment where the output is the concentration of some chemical component, then we would want our Gaussian process model to be always bounded between 0 and 1. Okay, so if we just want the model to be bounded between 0 and 1, we don't really need the rest of the talk because we could just, for instance, apply a logistic function or the inverse logistic function to the output and then go back to a standard Gaussian process model. So this talk is more useful for the second type of situation where we want our model to give, for instance, decreasing functions. Because in this case, we cannot only change each output separately. So we will need something more complex, for instance, the content of the talk. And For this, there are also motivations in computer experiments. For instance, we worked with a coastal risk analysis example, where some inputs were some waves conditions, especially the height of the waves, and then the output was a flooding surface on an area of interest. And here we wanted to enforce that the flooding surfaces increases with the height of the waves in the input. This will be an example of increasing functions. Okay, so we want a Gaussian process model, for instance, that gives only increasing function. And the difficulty with this is that saying that the function is increasing, it's infinite dimensional. So we cannot test directly if a function is increasing or impose it. So we need to make an approximation to go back to finite dimensional problems. So there are two main methods, or there are two methods, I would say. The first one would be to impose the constraint on some points. So we will add some pseudo observation points where we will just impose a positive derivative, for instance. So we will not do this. We'll use the second method, which is to approximate the continuous Gaussian process by a finite dimensional function. And here, as a finite dimensional function, we'll just take a piecewise linear function. We have these green crosses that I will call nodes in the rest of the talk. And we choose the position of some nodes. And from these nodes, the functions in the model, now they are piecewise linear with a change of linearity at the nodes. And the main benefit of this is that we can write simple constraints on the values at the nodes, for instance, to have increasing values. And then the constraints are satisfied on the nodes, if and only if the entire function satisfies the constraint. So if we want to be really sure that we satisfy the constraints, we can work with this finite dimensional models. So if we work with the previous pseudo observation points, then even if we had many of these points, they don't guarantee that we satisfy the constraints everywhere else. Because even if a Gaussian process has positive derivative on many points, still, with non-zero probability, it can have a negative derivative elsewhere if it's, for instance, from the matern or square exponential class. This is the motivation for working with nodes and finite dimensional approximations. And then we have a Gaussian process model that looks like this. So Ym of x is a model with a dimension m, and it's a sum of Gaussian coefficients alpha time basis function phi j. And for this basis function, we need to take the hat basis functions in order to have the equivalence between the finite dimensional constraints and the continuous constraints. And the hat basis functions are not the only possible choice, but they are the most convenient choice, in my opinion. So this is the prior, which is finite dimensional, with the vector alpha with some non-covariance matrix. That comes from, for instance, the matern covariance function of the continuous model that we approximate. And then we will work in regression. So personally, I did not work on this problem outside of Gaussian likelihood. But for instance, Andres, during his stay here in SecondMind, he worked on an extension of this to point processes. So in principle, the method can also work in other settings than regression. But here we'll consider regression with Gaussian errors. And then we have our linear inequalities that are like this. And with this, by choosing the vector LU and the matrix lambda, we can encode monotonicity, boundedness, or combinations. Yeah, maybe I did not specify, but don't hesitate to interrupt me with questions at any time, of course. And then, we can write the posterior corresponding to this prior with the constraint. So,
Henry, do you have a question? You seem puzzled.
No.
So it's convenient to write the posterior of lambda alpha, which is the vector that satisfies the constraint. And typically, we take lambda injective, so we can recover alpha. And then after some computation, we obtain that It follows a truncated Gaussian distribution with known mean vector and known covariance matrix, and then some component-wise bounds L and U. So the good thing is that it's a standard problem, for instance, in machine learning or computational statistics, to compute, for instance, moments of this truncated Gaussian distribution, or to approximately generate samples. So the most useful for us is to generate samples. So we tested several methods that are directly available in Python and R, or R for instance. And in the end, now we tend to use Hamiltonian Monte Carlo. And just to give a numerical ID, we work with this in dimension 1000 to 2000. And then after this, it stopped to work directly conveniently. Okay, so this was the construction in dimension one. And then when we want to go to dimension two or more, our main motivation is to keep this equivalence between the function is everywhere increasing with respect to two inputs, for instance, if and only if we have a finite number of constraints. So during André's PhD, our first attempt was to use the sparse grids, so not the full grids here. We tried first to use sparse grids to use less nodes in higher dimension. But with a sparse grid, we could not obtain an equivalence. So I don't know if it could be done, but we stopped trying. And then we concluded that we had to stay with full grid to have the equivalence, to be 100% sure that we satisfy the constraint. So we have a full grid like this. Then all the basis functions are just pyramids centered at one of the two-dimensional nodes, and which basis is given by the nodes around. And then with this, we can write similar linear equality constraints like this with the vector of the values at the nodes.
Sorry. Yeah, I think you said, but I didn't quite catch. So is it monotonic in all dimensions, or is it just one?
Not necessarily. Okay, so we choose. It's typically, it comes from the expertise on the model, and we choose the dimension with respect to which we want to be monotonic.
Okay, but you could do it for all of the inputs.
Yeah, and even if we are monotonic only with respect to input one, we still need to check this in the entire d-dimensional space here. So it does not really help the computation to be monotonic with only one variable, but still it's a bit better. Okay, so now general dimension D, we use a full grid. And that's the idea of this talk, is that we want to have a grid with less nodes, because each node corresponds to one more dimension is the Hamiltonian Monte Carlo sampling problem. And then because we want to keep full grid, we have two solutions to reduce the number of nodes. The first solution is to say that if there is one input variable x1, we would like not to have equispaced nodes. For instance, if the function is more difficult to learn the first half of x1, we would like to put more nodes here and then less nodes in the second half. Then the second solution is to say that if a variable is more important, for instance, if x1 is more important than x2, we would like to have many nodes on x1 and then maybe only two or three nodes for x2. And then also, if a variable is not important, we would like to allocate so to speak, zero nodes to it, meaning that it will not be active in the model. So we have two elements that we can choose, which is for each variable, the number of nodes and if it's active or inactive, and also for each variable, the location of the nodes. And now, the intuition is that let's say we have a budget, we say we want to use a maximum of 1000 nodes, for instance, to keep the computation convenient, and now we want to allocate these nodes. It's a very complex combinatorial optimization problem, and then the MaxMod algorithm is just a greedy approach to this, which will add nodes sequentially. And each time it will add nodes, it will optimize the greedy criterion, and then it will add the nodes, and then it will never go back to remove some of the nodes. will now present the algorithm.
Before you go on, so you're going to talk about how you managed to scale this in terms of like dimension.
Yeah.
Are there like other ways to extend this? Like, has anyone done it for like maybe a unimodal function? Is there an obvious way that you could use a similar idea for
a unimodal function?
Yeah, so like one that's got one mode.
Ah.
So rather than always increasing it, increases then decreases, for example.
Yes. So I think if we don't know where the mode is, I think it's not obvious.
Yeah.
Maybe it could be done, but maybe the constraints would not be linear.
Yes.
On the nodes.
So you can have constraints on the second derivative, right? So you can say you're convex or things like that with these settings.
Yeah, we can be convex, but we could also be unimodal and non-convex, I guess.
Yeah.
And this, maybe it will deserve some investigation.
Yeah. If it's unimodal non-convex, I'm not sure how to do it. But if it's just being convex, you're saying that the second derivative is positive and you're good to go. You don't have to change anything.
Yeah. But so this would be if you knew where the... Oh, no. So this wouldn't matter with it about knowing where the...
For convexity, no, it doesn't matter.
Yeah.
Okay,
interesting. Thanks.
Oh, thank you. Okay, so before I said that the most interesting thing to compute in the end for us are the conditional samples, but then these conditional samples, they are costly to obtain. And so for the maximal algorithm, we would like to have a kind of proxy to these conditional samples that is quicker to compute and still give predictions from a constrained Gaussian process model. And then the best proxy that we found is the mode. So the intuition of the mode is that alpha is a Gaussian vector which has a conditional distribution given by the observations and also by the constraints. And then the mode is just correspond to the alpha hat which has the largest likelihood, conditional likelihood. So the mode is obtained by optimizing the likelihood, which is a quadratic function of alpha, given inequality constraints that correspond, for instance, to being increasing. And this, in practice, it's cheaper to obtain than the conditional samples. And also, there are some routines that already exist for this. So during the background algorithm, we will use the mode to have some predictions from the model. So for any given set of nodes, we can compute the mode and it will give us a y hat m, which will be the prediction function. Okay, so I said that the y hat m is the point estimate. So it's a prediction, but it does not have confidence intervals associated. So it's faster to compute. So I will come back to this in the theoretical part of the talk. But when the number of nodes goes to infinity and when the nodes are dense in the space, then the mode converges to a function that's called the spleen solution of an interpolation problem with a linear inequality constraint. And the spleen solution, so it's infinite dimensional, so it cannot be computed directly, but it's considered to be theoretically interesting and optimal. Then we have some plot just for illustration. So we have three observations with no noise. And then we have in blue, the posterior mean, which is the average of the conditional samples. And in red, we have the mode. So they are quite similar. The difference you can see is maybe here, is that the mode, so to speak, it's at the boundary of the support. So if you imagine, for instance, in dimension one, a truncated Gaussian distribution, the truncature is, if the part that we keep is of probability smaller than one, then the truncated Gaussian distribution, the density, it's a decreasing function. Maybe I will not use a whiteboard because there are some people on Zoom.
Up to you, but yeah, I think
it makes sense.
Okay, yeah, okay, perfect. So here the blue function is strictly increasing, so it's inside the support. And then the mod looks at the boundary of the support because it's all mod almost constant. Okay, so I mentioned the idea of using a non-equally spaced knots to favor some regions. And with a non-equally spaced knots, we will have asymmetric triangular functions. But it will be the same computations as in the equally spaced case. Okay, so meaning especially that we'll have the same equivalence between the continuous constraints and the finite dimensional number of constraints. Okay, now I will first present the maximum dimorphism in dimension one because it's easier to present that way. So at each step, we have a set of knots, so T0, Tm from 0 to 1. And then we want to add a new knot somewhere. And the criterion that we consider, it will be the modification of the maximum a posteriori function, which is the prediction. So we say that a new knot is useful if it changes the prediction that we have, that it makes it more flexible, more non-linear, for instance. And so we choose the position of the new knot as the maximizer of the square difference between the current mod and the new mod with the new knot. So we will optimize this over 0,1, so with a grid search, for instance. And so we need to compute this for any potential t in 0,1. So there is a first computational cost, which is the dominant one, which is to compute the new mod. So we solve the optimization problem. And then once the new mod is computed, actually it's just given by the vector of coefficients. So we have coefficients for the basis functions. And then we can use the Gram matrix of the basis functions that can pre-compute. And with this, we don't have the integral to evaluate numerically. So it will just be a quadratic form, even with a sparse matrix. The only annoying cost is to compute this mod y hat. Then the integral is not problematic. And then we have the algorithm, which, as I said, is just for any k, we add a new knot, which maximizes this integral of the square difference.
One question, François. When you're in dimension more than one, when you say you add a node, are you actually adding
a vector?
D times the grid size nodes.
Yes.
Okay.
So, yeah, in multi-dimension, we have to keep the grid
structure
temporized.
Okay.
So when we add a node for variable one, for instance, we need to add all the nodes
for the corresponding nodes. All the grids. Yeah.
I will come back to.
Okay.
Okay, so some illustration. So we start with three observation points. And then we start typically with a very simple model. So we start with only two knots. So the model only gives the linear functions. And then we evaluate the maximum criterion and it tells us to add the third knot here, which gives now one bend here. And then we continue. So at each step, we add a new knot. And then we see that the knots are not equally spaced. So especially at the end, we can see that the algorithm focused on this part where the curve is stronger. And then this, there were no knots here because it's relatively linear. Okay. And then the algorithm more or less has converged because the model does not change when we add the new knots. And okay, so these are the modes. And then we can have a look at the conditional sample pass corresponding to each model. So at the beginning, it's only the mean function that changes. And then we start to see conditional samples with more flexibility. And then again, after some time, the confidence intervals they stabilize. So again, the model has converged. Okay, and typically in practice, first we run max mod until we have all the knots, and then we do this Monte Carlo procedure only for the last step. This is the point of the algorithm. Okay, so in higher dimension, I will start with your comment that if we want to add one node to variable one, maybe I will show an example. Let's say we want to add one node here for x1, but then to keep the grid centralized, we need to add the nodes also here. So the number of new nodes is the number of nodes of x2 in this two-dimensional case. So in general, each time we add a node to a variable I, the number of basis functions is increased by some number n. This number is smallest when we add a node where there are already many nodes. This number is largest when we add a node somewhere where there were few nodes. And then the criterion is again the L2 change of the mode between the current mode and the mode after one more node. But we renormalize, we divide by the number of additional nodes because we penalize the computational cost of adding more nodes. And then also now, not all the variables are active. So there are some variables that are active, meaning that they have two nodes or more. And then some variables are inexistent in the model. And at each step, the algorithm can also decide to add one new variable. So, yeah.
You say you penalize because of the computational cost, but the computational cost would be cubic in the number of observation. Right? Is there what's the rationale for having a linear penalization here?
Yeah, it's a good question. I think we did not put too much thought on this, so we just tried this. But maybe a cubic penalization will be better.
I really don't know. Just it's okay. Thanks.
But yes, yeah, I agree that the computational cost is cubic. Yeah. Okay, so the first possibility is when we add a node to a variable that was already active, then we just compute the L2 difference of the mode. And we have to optimize the position on the node on 0, 1. And then the possibility is when there was one inactive variable that we make active. In this case, we don't have to choose where the node is. Because when we introduce a new variable, we just put two nodes, one at zero and one at one, which give a function that will be only linear with respect to this new variable. But still, the gain of adding one new variable is again the L2 difference of the mode. OK, so this is algorithms. It's what I describe. And then we'll see just an illustration in dimension two. We have a function which is increasing with respect to inputs x1 and x2. So these are the constraints that are imposed to the model. And then we run the MaxMode algorithm. So for the initialization of the MaxMode algorithm, we start with a very simple model. So typically, we start with a model with only one active variable and two nodes for this variable. And to choose the active variable, we can do simple things. So here we just do a linear regression with one exploratory variable and one output, and we take the largest slope. This gives the initial variable. And then we run the MaxMode algorithm. So at the first step, MaxMode will decide not to make the variable x1 active, but to reinforce variable x2 by adding one node here, which is a bit of a turning point of the mode. And here, there was, of course, a good change of the mode with this. And it's also the smallest number of additional nodes because it's only one. Then at the second iteration, the algorithm will decide to make variable one active. So now the number of nodes is doubled. So it's always like this when we add a new variable. And now we are linear with respect to x2, to x1. And we still have this form with respect to x2. And now we have a 2D prediction that go in the middle of the point cloud. And then at the next iteration, it's again x2 that will be reinforced with a new node here. And at the next iteration, still x2 will be reinforced here. Okay. So We can show that this is more accurate than using square grids, which was our objective. So here in dimension two, we can use square grids of nodes, so 2 times 2, 3 times 2, and 4 times 4. And this will give this relative error. So the L2 difference of the mod minus the function divided by the L2 difference of the function. And then we see that with max mod, with less nodes, we have smaller errors. And then the number of nodes also is flexible. When we have only one variable, it's 1, it's 2, and then 3. Then it becomes 6. And then when we reinforce the second variable, it becomes 8, 10. And then 15 is something I did not show. It's a third node on the first variable. Okay, so this is something that we introduced for the mathematical analysis of algorithm. So not so much for the practice. That to prove the convergence of the algorithm, we had to promote the fact of adding nodes that are not too close to existing nodes. So we added to the integral criterion what I call a reward, which is delta times the distance of the new nodes to the existing nodes if we reinforce one existing variable, and then some number delta prime if we add a new variable. So for the proof, it's important that delta and delta prime are non-zero. And in practice, we have put very small values to them so that they do not impact on, they don't make an impact on the results. And then this is a modified max mode algorithm with this reward. And the idea is just that we optimize the integral normalized by the number of stationary nodes. And now plus this reward term R.
So this reward is to give an incentive to make all variables active?
Yes.
Okay.
And also to cover the entire 0-1 input space for each variable.
Okay.
With this distance to the existing nodes. Yeah.
Okay.
Okay, so we can discuss some numerical results. So I've considered a target function, which is this sum of one-dimensional functions. So it has dimension small d that will be considered from 2 to 5. And then the most important variable is variable 1. And then the other variable, because of this I over d plus 1, they are less and less important. So we hope that more nodes will go to variable 1 than the other ones, for instance. And then to test the dimensional reduction, we also include some fake variables. So capital D minus D variables that are in the black box functions, but that are inactive. And then we'll test for capital D from 5 to 20. Then we'll have observation points with 10 times the dimension points. And then we run the max mode algorithm until we reach a stopping rule, which is that the maximum over all possible choices of the mode modification plus the reward plus the reward is small. It's a numerical indicator of convergence, one step ahead convergence of the algorithm. And then, as I say, we make the reward non-impactful by taking very small values here. Okay. And then this table, first it tells us that we have good prediction in the end, because after convergence of AxMod, each time the relative error is small, so 10 to the minus 5 to 10 to the minus 3. When we are in a larger dimension D, then the error is larger. And then here we see that each time the good variables are selected, for instance here, the variables 1, 2, 3 are active only, and MaxMod selects 1, 2, 3. And then we see that in general, there are more nodes that go to the first variable. For instance, with 5, 3, then 4, 4, 3. So there are some exceptions. So for instance, here, it's the second variable that has most nodes. But in general, we were happy about this result. Okay, so it's the end of the practical methodology part of this talk. So what we liked is that with the full grid, we were constrained to dimension 5, maybe just a bit more with some manual interventions. And with this, we can go in here until dimension 20. So this was good for us in the prospect of computer models, where we have a range of problems where we want to emulate computer models where the input dimension starts at 2, 3, and then is until 20. So there are some other problems more complex where the dimension can reach 50 of 100. The dimension 50 we did not try, but maybe with some dimension reduction step we could use max mode algorithm. Okay, so for the moment, yeah.
So do you compare against just randomly hitting knots? Did you compare against randomly?
Ah,
because obviously that would scale well, but is it rubbish?
We did not try. So you mean a randomly allocated knots?
Yeah, so rather than like a grid, you could just kind of sample.
Ah, yes, but if the knots do not form a grid, then we don't have our equivalent.
Oh, of course, yeah. Yeah, sorry, that was a
silly
question.
No,
thank you.
Yes, but there is something. There's something that we can do, which is also to compare to Gaussian processes that do not enforce the constraints, or to compare to Gaussian processes that enforce the constraints by means of the constraint points. Because in this case, they don't need to have grids. So it's something that we did not do, but I think it will be interesting as well. Okay. So let's say that now MaxMod is useful with this type of dimension. Maybe it can be useful in higher dimensional cases after using a smaller dimensional representation of the data. And then I think for Olivier, Andres, Nicolas, if you are interested, I think the next step will be to try to have more additive Gaussian process models that would maintain this equivalence between the constraints everywhere and the constraints at the nodes, but that would be applicable in a higher dimension, especially with image inputs as in some machine learning application. So this would be a prospect for future work for us. Okay.
There are 15 minutes.
15 minutes. Okay. So I will try to present some of the mathematical arguments of the convergence analysis. So the idea is that after some trial and errors for us, we understood that it was convenient to introduce this object, which is what we call the multi-affine extension of function, because it was good to express our convergence results and to prove them. So the idea is that we start with a function which is defined not on the entire hypercube, so here in dimension 2, but on a subset of it, which is a tensorized set of the form F1 times Ft. And each of the F1 Fd, there are closed subsets that contain 0 and 1. So here, the function is only defined in the blue input. And then the continuous extension, it extends this function to a function defined everywhere by using one-dimensional linear extensions. So first, it extends with x2 by putting lines. And then when this is done, it can extend with respect to x1 again by putting lines. So here, it's defined just with a simple set, which is composed of two intervals. But in general, it can be defined for any closed sets, even very abstract ones. And then it can be shown that the order, for instance, using first x2 and then x1, does not matter. We could have done the extension the other way around and obtain the same result. Another characterization of this extension is that it is a unique continuous function that coincides with the function on f, and that is affine in dimension 1 when we are outside of the blue space. It will be affine here, then it can be affine here, and also affine here.
It cannot be linear in both directions in the center, can it?
No, exactly. In the center, it's not a linear function.
Okay.
There is an interaction term x1 times x2.
Yes. But you say so, it's affine, so what does affine mean?
I meant affine when considered in one dimension. So I mean it's affine on one dimensional segment.
Okay, that I got it.
Okay. So in fact, in the center, it is a polynomial function that uses x variable at most once.
Yep.
So it's a coefficient constant plus coefficient time x1, time x2, and then time x1, x2.
Yes.
Okay. And this, intuitively, it looks like the hat function a lot. So when we are in the center, for instance, it looks like a function that can be computed with four hat functions at the four hypercorners. So this is why it's connected to the hat functions and thus to the convergence of the max mode algorithm. But we have also a more explicit expression of this. It's a combination of hat functions. At any point, which is not in the blue domain, for instance, here in the center, we can take the 2D vertices of the hypercubes that contain the point. And then with these 2D vertices, we have an expression like this of the multi-affine extension. And we have some results that show that this extension, it works well with preserving monotonicity or component-wise convexity and boundedness. Okay, so there's something that I will skip. Then I will talk about the convergence results. So first, I will discuss the existing results by Xavier B, Laurence Gramont, and Hassan Batouk. So we consider the noise-free case. So we consider exact interpolation of functions. And we have a fixed data set. So we are interested in convergence as the number of nodes go to infinity. So very often in statistics and machine learning, the number of data go to infinity. It's maybe more an optimization perspective. We have a fixed data set. We run our optimization algorithm for long, and then we ask if it converges to something that is optimal for the data set. We'll write I for the set of functions that interpolate the data. Then we write C for the set of functions that satisfy the inequality constraints. For instance, the set of increasing functions in dimension one. And then we will also consider one reproducible kernel Hilbert space. So at the very beginning of the model, we choose a kernel, which is the kernel of the continuous Gaussian process. For instance, the Matern kernel. And then from this kernel, we have the covariance matrix of the values at the nodes, and we have all the prior and the posterior.
Yeah. Potentially a stupid question. Is C a subset of H?
Not necessarily, but yes, because we intersect them. So we could take C as a subset of H. It would give the same result.
But it is possible to end up with some functions, so sample draws, I guess, from your method that wouldn't.
Yes.
Yeah. Okay.
So
it's not just a subset of functions that are monotonic.
See.
Yeah.
Yeah. Maybe I did not provide a good answer. I think it's better if C is not a subset of H, because H typically it does not contain the piecewise linear functions. Because with the Matern kernel, it will contain only differentiable functions. But C, it allows also for the finite dimensional functions. So it's not a subset of H, yes. But in H, there are also functions that are in C. So this is a necessary condition. Okay. And then here, for each variable J, we have a sequence of nodes that is dense in 0,1 with the number of nodes mj that goes to infinity. And this gives us a sequence of map y hat that are functions from 0,1, this is a small d, sorry, to r. And then in this paper, they showed that this sequence of map function, they converge to a function y opt which is what I refer to as the spleen solution. So y-opt is a function which is in the RKHS of the kernel. So it's smoother than the finite dimensional approximations. It interpolates the data set, and it satisfies the inequality constraints. And among these functions, it has the smallest RKHS norm. So the smallest complexity intuitive. This is the existing result. And then to study the max mode algorithm, the first question we had is, what happens now when the knots are not dense in 0, 1? Can we still converge to something that looks like this? So we tried to do this. So now, for each variable j, we have a sequence of knots that is not necessarily dense, but it has a closure, which is a closed set fj in 0, 1. And now we ask, do we have a convergence of the sequence of knots? So first, we tried to work still on the entire space 0, 1, d. But with this, we tried to work on this and to extend the proof of Begramont-Matouk. But it was not possible because in this proof, they really need the knots to be dense. And so after that, we decided it was better to work in a framework where the knots are dense. And so we decided to study functions defined only on the closure F1 time L. And so we extended these three sets to this closure set F. So we defined HF as the RKHS of K now restricted to F. Then CF is the set of functions from F to R for which, when we take the multi-affine extension, then we satisfy the inequality constraints. And then IF, the set of functions from F to R, for which, when we take the multi-affine extension, then we interpolate the data set. And with this, we have the same result as them, meaning that the mode function y hat, it converges to an optimal function y opt on the closure set F, and y opt is the same function as before. So it's in the RKHS, it satisfies the inequality constraints, it interpolates the data after the multi-affine extension, and then we minimize the RKHS norm. And the good thing is that with this, we can just apply again the multi-affine extension, and we have the convergence that we wanted. That the mode, it converges to the multi-affine extension of this optimal y-opt. So when the knots are not dense, the mode, it converges to a new function, which is different from the function in Matouk and B. And then this convergence to something, it was enough for us to prove the convergence of max mode. So as the number of iterations goes to infinity, max mode converges to the optimal function y opt, which is defined as in the paper by B, Gramont, and Matouk. So it converges to the optimal spleen solution. Yeah. And the idea of this proof, it's an argument that is a standard in the proof of greedy algorithms, especially in Gaussian processes like expected global improvement of SUR, stepwise uncertainty reduction algorithms. We show that the acquisition function, so the function that is optimized, is small at points that are close to existing points. And to show this small, we use the convergence of the mode that we showed previously. And then we also need to show that the acquisition function is large for new points that are away from existing points. And to show this second part, we needed to have this reward that I mentioned before. And then with this, we have the convergence of max. Okay, so I will just conclude quickly. So the max mode algorithm, there are two ideas. The first is to insert knots that are not equispaced. And the second one is to add active variables so that at the beginning, not all the variables are active. And then it's a greedy algorithm. So we have shown that it was working until dimension 20. And then I mentioned the prospect of considering, let's say, even more approximate models like additive models to satisfy the constraints in higher dimension. And then we have obtained the proof of convergence of the algorithm for a fixed data set. So we converge to an optimal infinite dimensional model. And as a mean for obtaining this proof, we have considered in general the case of finite dimensional Gaussian toothless models when the knots are not dense in the input domain. And for this, we have suggested the notion of multi-affine extension. Okay, so I will conclude by pointing out some references. So this is a preprint from this talk. And these two papers are the convergence papers when the knots are dense. This is the PhD thesis from Andrés. This is the initial paper for Andrés and the three supervisors on finite dimensional models. This is a previous paper also on finite dimensional model with constraints. Then this is an article on Hamiltonian Monte Carlo for truncated Gaussian solution. Then this is your book on Gaussian processes. Okay, so I will stop here. So thank you very much for attending.
Thanks for coming.
I have a brief question. When you decide to introduce knots, does the criterion only depend on the mean prediction of the model? And could you change it so that it asks, does the mass, the predictive mass move around?
Yes.
Is that possible? And would it have any advantages?
So I think in principle, it's possible to ask that not only the mean change, but the entire predictive density, for instance. But then maybe so outside of computational consideration, maybe it will be more useful. But then the difficulty is that the mode which is the fastest to compute, it's only give a mean, which is not a mean, it's more highest density point. But if you want to have the entire distribution, for instance, with standard deviations or samples, then it's more costly to obtain.
Do you assume so you said your algorithm works in the case of regression, right? So then you have to know variance, I guess. Do you assume you have a known variance?
I did not mention this at all, but we have to choose the variance of the noise.
Mm-hmm.
We have to allocate a value to this, and then we have to choose the kernel k at the very beginning. And for this, these are parameters that we need to optimize, like the variance, length scale, and then the noise variance.
Because I could imagine if you misspecify your noise variance quite badly, you would like not satisfy, especially like on slide 13, you had this example where the noise was actually quite high. If you were to misspecify the noise to be much smaller, then I guess satisfying these constraints can be challenging. And how would the algorithm cope with that?
So this is a bit of a misleading post plot. This is not a noise.
Oh,
that it's a two-dimensional function.
Yeah. Okay.
But I think actually the noise variant computationally it helps the max mode algorithm because the mode or the predictions they are less constrained to be close to the existing points.
Mm-hmm.
So there's no noise in this example.
Yeah. There is no noise. Yes.
So you said the last, if I understood correctly, the fifth iteration split the other variable.
Yeah.
But why does that not add zero inference? Because the objective is linear in that variable and it says no noise.
Yeah.
Then how can it choose that variable?
I think because
I thought it was chosen because of noise, but
when is it split? This one? It's just one the split.
Iteration 5.
The one that is not represented here.
We'll add one knot here.
Okay.
But I think it's.
Why? It's. You said that because you know it, right? We can't see it.
Just because of the 15, it's a bit.
Okay.
So I think it could still be a confounding factor, right? Let's say you have little data, you can always get it wrong and think that a variation in one dimension is explained by a variation in the other. I'm not saying it's the case here, but you could always improve the model. But
doesn't go far enough to be able to imagine that on the fly.
Yeah.
I think it might be true, It's not obvious to me whether that could be true.
Thank you. with a bad pattern for the location of the point, you could always explain one a function of one variable by a function of the other.
Yeah, I think if there are no two points aligned,
yes,
then your point cloud can be interpolated by one dimensional functions
or the other
with the two variables.
Yes,
I think so.
So it's not impossible to get it wrong, I guess. That's
I assume that we don't have perfect interpolation after adding one more node. I think maybe it's due to the position of the point cloud or on the fact that it's non-linear with variable two. So we will have to check this. What I was saying was that Andres pointed out that when the noise variance of the model is higher, the Monte Carlo part is simpler. So the chains have better properties because more often the vectors that are proposed satisfy the constraints. I think the intuition is that there are less constraints to interpolate the points strongly. Yeah.
But if you misspecify the variance, how does the algorithm behave then?
I guess that you over specify it or
if you specify the noise too small than it actually is, then I can believe it's very hard to actually interpolate the data.
Yeah.
The algorithm could get stuck there.
Yeah, absolutely. Okay. So for instance, if we impose no noise in the model and if the observation points are noisy, it will not be possible typically to find one interpolator that satisfies the constraints.
Okay, yeah.
And then the algorithm will be stuck.
So then you have to do some hyperparameter learning first and then
Go back. Okay. And then we can learn the hyperparameters as usual, so not taking the constraints into account.
Mm.
And also it's possible to adapt the likelihood to the constraints, but then the likelihood is more complex to compute.
One question. There are a lot of similarities with random forest because you take your space and then you split it and then you split it again. You had a one-dimensional degree of freedom in some direction.
Yeah.
Could that be seen as like regularized random forest with where you account for this quadratic term in your likelihood?
I did not think about this.
But random forests are constant.
They are piecewise constant.
And this one is piecewise linear. So that would be a difference. But
So what is the quadratic term?
The one of the likelihood that you use.
Yes, for the mode.
Yes, because you're looking at the mode.
This one?
Yes.
Okay.
So random forest won't have that. It would just minimize the error, right?
Yeah. Yeah, they will. They will just minimize the errors. Yes.
But still, it looks a bit. It looks like a regularized random forest, or random tree.
Yeah, I agree with. But yeah, I had not think about this before.
Also, when you fit an individual tree in a random forest, you kind of go down in the greedy manner, and then sometimes you go back up again. So you do like the pruning. Is there any sort of similar trick you might be able to do here?
Also, we did not think about this.
This is quite challenging, very combinatorial.
Yeah, we could think about this. But then, when pruning random forests, you need to have a tree somewhere. So, here, I
guess it'd be hard to work out.
I'm not sure
get rid of. I guess.
I'm not sure we can see a tree here.
Well, I think you get rid of one of the...
We can remove plane of of nodes.
Yeah.
Can you use... So there's no grid in that method, right? Because the grid keeps getting... It's a different grid within the different subsets.
Yes.
Right, there's no global grid.
Yes, that's true.
Yeah, I guess. Sorry.
Is it possible to maybe, you know, once you have a knot, you have like a plane to this knot, is it possible to consider the split separately and run them in parallel? Because you know, we never remove knots, right?
So
like on the step of the algorithm, once you have added a knot,
yeah,
right, or like a couple of knots, is it possible, like, to kind of introduce a plane, right? Is it possible to consider each side of this plane separately? Because this knot will never be removed.
Mm.
So like you kind of you can optimize that and optimize it in parallel.
Yes. Okay.
Is it possible?
I don't know. I think the problem with Gaussian processes is that if we do exact inference, everything is dependent because of the global covariance matrix. So alpha, which is the vector of values at the nodes everywhere, does a full covariance matrix that is not a block diagonal. So this, I guess, would be a difficulty to parallelize.
Okay, I think we are pretty much our. Oh yes, we are actually over time. Sorry for that. Thanks a lot, François, for the talk.